to you for their assistance in our worship services every Sunday. I hope you will take an opportunity to thank those who volunteer their time to do that. I'm going to forego my jokes because I can't top puns this morning. And plus, I got a little caught up in a ball game late yesterday afternoon. I may have a little voice trouble as a result. I hope you all saw that game and made note of who won. I am glad to see you this morning, and it is grateful to be with you, to be a part of the St. Paul community. I want to ask you to turn in your Bibles to the 40th chapter of Isaiah. If you do not have your scripture, the bulletin prints most of what I'm going to read. I'm going to read the entire chapter, though we start with verse 9 in the bulletin. So if you don't have your Bibles, when I get through verse 8, you can start following with the bulletin. The Bible is the Word of God, our only infallible rule of faith and practice. In this book, God reveals Himself and He speaks to us of what He would have us believe and how He would have us to live. His Word is inspired. It's without error. So let's attend to the reading of His holy word. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord is spoken. A voice says, cry. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. And now verse 9. Get up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not, say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and His arm rules for Him. Behold, His reward is with Him and His recompense before Him. He will tend His flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in His arms, and He will carry them in His bosom, gently lead those that are with young. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of His hand and marked off the heavens with a span? And closed the dust of the earth in a measure, and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who has measured the Spirit of the Lord? Or what man shows Him His counsel? Whom did He consult? And who made Him understand? Who taught Him the path of justice and taught Him knowledge and showed Him the way of understanding? Behold, the nations are like a drop in a bucket, and are accounted as the dust on the scales. Behold, He takes up the coastlands like fine dust. Lebanon would not suffice for fuel, nor are its beasts enough for a burnt offering. All nations are as nothing before Him. They are counted by Him as less than nothing and emptiness. To whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness compare Him? An idol? A craftsman cast it. A goldsmith overlays it with gold and cast it for silver chains. He who is too impoverished for an offering chooses wood that will not rot. He seeks out a skillful craftsman to set up an idol that will not move. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows on them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And may God bless this reading and our understanding of this portion of his holy word. Would you pray with me? Father, we ask you to make these words certainly your word to us this day. Teach us, humble us, strengthen us as we look to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Look at the title of the sermon, and I want you to think about that for a minute. How well do you know God? When you go to school, you have to take certain courses in a curriculum. And there are some courses that build for other courses to follow. For example, if you wanted to take second or third year Spanish, you would probably have to take first year Spanish. There are a number of courses in my school experience where I went through that, of course. And only one or two in the seminary was I able to opt out, because sometimes you can take a comprehensive test and may be exempt from taking a certain course. But again, the idea is that with prerequisites in the curriculum, you may be able to handle certain courses later as they come in your study. And you know, it works that way with our beliefs. Some people try to jump into the middle of a curriculum without taking certain prerequisites, and they find themselves struggling and confused, and sometimes they just drop out because of their lack of understanding. And that's true with Christianity as well. We can jump into the curriculum of the Christian life maybe before we're ready to be where we're trying to be at a certain point. And we need to back up, and we need to re-examine the basics and look at the foundation and begin to see where the different parts of the Christian faith actually fit into the whole of the curriculum. A note from history: you're familiar with the Protestant Reformation. It happened in the 16th century. Basically, when a young monk by the name of Martin Luther started reading the Bible himself, and he discovered a truth that salvation was not by works, that salvation was not by faith and works, that salvation was by faith alone. And the famous doctrine of justification was associated with Martin Luther. We call that the first phase of the Protestant Reformation. The second phase happened shortly afterwards under the leadership of a man by the name of John Calvin. Calvin was aware of Luther's work and very appreciative for what God led Luther to emphasize in salvation by faith alone. But more than Luther, Calvin, while he believed that the bigger picture was where we needed to be, focusing on the sovereignty of God. So while Calvin agreed with justification by faith alone, his emphasis in the second phase of the Protestant Reformation was to encourage us to see God in His fullness, in His sovereignty. Now, not to shortchange Luther, Luther did write on other things than justification by work. But we do need to see the broader aspect of the Christian faith, because Christianity, as you've heard me say, deals more than simply with our salvation. Sometime back, I was studying Psalm 139. Hope to preach on that while I'm here. It's one of my favorite psalms. But as I was reading Psalm 139 and I came to verse 17, I read David's words where he says, "How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God." And as I read that verse, and I'd read it many times before, I remember stopping and immediately identifying with that statement. But I thought, you know, that's not the way it usually works. What often happens is when we think about God, we think our thoughts about God, what we think and feel about Him, rather than, as David says, think God's thoughts about Him. And you know what I thought as I was thinking about that? I thought, you know, that's where we get into such confusion and misunderstanding about truth and reality in the Christian faith, is because we end up thinking our thoughts about things instead of thinking God's thoughts. And you know, I thought, I can think like God wants me to think because I'm made in His image and likeness. And because of that, I can't deny God. Because basic logic 101 says in order to deny something, you have to first of all affirm it anyway. That's why technically there's no real true atheist around. We have to deny something, affirm it in order to deny it. So people universally accept the existence of God. As a matter of fact, if you have read Gallup polls, for example, he says 95% of Americans believe in the existence of God or some supreme being. And I think he's right up to a point, but I would say to Gallup, there are 5% more of the people too who also believe in a God, if only to deny Him. But living in our postmodern age where truth, if there is that, determined by the individual, God is often a meaningless concept, because somehow we've been convinced with this postmodern mindset that we can make God, him or her, into whatever we want them to be. The tragedy of this is if our knowledge of God is faulty, then our whole concept of life and reality is going to be faulty as well. That's why the writer of Proverbs says the fear of the Lord, or the knowledge of God, is our beginning point. What we need to do in our Christian lives is be sure we have covered the bases with the basic truths in the curriculum. And we do that by learning to think God's thoughts after Him. Not what we may try to concoct about God, but what God says to us in His Word about Himself. In the past several years, I've had an opportunity to review a number of books on the topic of the knowledge of God. One was written by my dear friend John Frame, who is a teaching elder in the PCA and a professor and writer at Reformed Seminary in Orlando. And another was written by a professor of theology at Trinity Evangelical Seminary, John Feinberg. And I stated in my review of both those books, as I read those books, it became more and more impressed upon me that right where we are in this early part of the 21st century, what we need to know more than anything else, what we need to have is a right knowledge of God. Not merely what we think about God, but what God tells us about Himself. You see, simply knowing that there's a God is not enough to assure us that we have a right knowledge of God. And let me give you a contemporary example so you hopefully understand what I'm talking about. There's an issue that's been going about among evangelical Christian circles over the past several years that has caused no small amount of concern within the evangelical circles. It's a teaching that's going about based, I believe, on a faulty knowledge of God. And it has caused no small amount of confusion among a lot of Christian people. You may not have heard of it, but in specifically academic circles, it's there. It's sometimes referred to as open theism. Or you may hear the openness of God movement. I wouldn't be so concerned about this teaching if I thought it was taught by a bunch of liberals who do not put a lot of stock into the authority of the Scripture. But the thing that makes it so disturbing for me and others is it's being taught by those who profess to be evangelical Christians and who believe the Bible. What it basically teaches is this. Yes, God exists. Yes, God is a personal God. And yes, God offers salvation to people through Jesus Christ. And yes, God knows all things, and here it is, but only after they happen. That's basically what open theism deals with. In other words, God knows all things about the past and the present, but He doesn't know all things about the future. His knowledge and what's going to happen in the future is up for grabs. What open theism actually becomes, I think, is a way to rationalize how bad things happen to good people by saying, God didn't know that was going to happen. You can't blame God. It challenges what the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians 1, that God knows and controls all things that come to pass. And what it would simply boil down to is that God didn't know that September 11th was going to happen. He didn't know Katrina was going to do what it did. He didn't know that Newtown massacre was going to take place and so on and so on. But as God learns about those things, this position says, being God, He can come in and begin to pick up the pieces. And He can begin to do what Paul says, to work all things together for good to those who know Him. But God didn't know beforehand that those were going to happen. And He didn't know who was going to be saved until man cried out to Him for salvation. And when man decides to cry out to God, then God will save that individual. Now, it's one thing for postmodernists coming from their non-Christian philosophical framework to say things like that about God, but it's another thing for those who profess to be Christians to do the same. It doesn't make any sense, especially to people like us who are Presbyterians, who are of the legacy of John Calvin and his emphasis upon in the Protestant Reformation. Our Westminster Confession of Faith, which contains the summary of the doctrines that we believe are taught in Scripture, reflects something of God's thoughts as clearly as possible at the time of their writing. And it underscores very clearly that the God of the Bible is the sovereign God who controls all things that come to pass. Does that mean we understand it completely? Of course not. To understand something completely would make us to be God. And remember, that's what Adam and Eve tried to do in the garden that got us into the mess that we're in today. There's mystery to the Christian faith. In one sense, I think we can say from a philosophical standpoint that Christians are the true mystics, because we walk by faith and not by sight. Now, does that bother you to think about you're not being able to know everything God knows? Does that trouble you at all? To realize that we'll never know everything God knows, not even in heaven, even when we will not be seeing through a glass darkly? I'm challenged to know as much as I can about God. I want to grow in the grace and the knowledge of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But I am so glad, my friends, that I don't know everything there is to know about God. What a comfort that is to me. What a relief to know that there are things that I don't know. That gives me hope. That gives me courage. It gives me a desire to keep pressing on in my Christian life. Now, there's some things I know about God today that I didn't know 10 years ago. And there's some things I know today about God from 10 years ago that I've had to edit and change some of my thinking as I've grown in learning more about God. As we come to the Lord's table in a little while, there are two things I want you to experience in coming to the table. I want you to come knowing the truth of the gospel and the person of Christ. But I also want you to know that in knowing Christ and coming to his table, there's mystery here. There's mystery here that we will never fully comprehend. So we come in faith to his table. Some time ago, I was asked in the course of one of our seminars that we conducted around the denomination and churches that I was doing on apologetics. And someone asked me, Charles, in light of what you're saying about the modern postmodernism, what's the most important thing, the most important topic for Christians to think about today? And I try to take questions seriously and not answer too quickly. And I thought about that. Oh, there's so many things. Life, mercy, justice, compassion, discipleship. But then it came to me, the most important thing for us today is to learn to think God's thoughts after him. As Paul said in 2 Corinthians 10, we're to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And to do that properly, we have to start with God. And in order to start with God, we also have to study the Bible. But as we study the Bible, it's very important for us to do this in the context of the church in some accountability structure, in order to be sure that we properly understand what God is saying to us in His Word. We need one another for that. That's why the Apostle Peter said, and it was repeated in our doctrinal standards, the Westminster Standards, no scripture is of private interpretation. We need the discipline of one another as we study the Bible corporately. If you remember a lesson from history, and I may have mentioned this on another occasion, I'm not sure, but New England became very liberal philosophically and theologically in the 1800s because of something called the New Light Movement. And the New Light Movement was made up of people who said, I don't need the church to understand the Bible. I don't need creeds. I don't need confessions. All I need is the Bible. That sounds very pious on the surface. And it is true that the Bible is sufficient in all that it teaches. But it's also true that we need one another in order to be certain that we're understanding the Word of God for what it intends to say. You see, to do otherwise, friends, in the New Light Movement as an example, is what the cults and the occults have grown from. This passage I read for you in Isaiah 40, and I had to read the entire chapter because it's one of those great passages in the Bible that I think summarizes God's grand narrative story about Himself. And it certainly reminds us of the truth of what I'm saying about God. Or should I say, I think in Isaiah 40, God clearly establishes the truth that I'm talking about. And it was originally written by Isaiah the prophet to people who were not too unlike us today. They were in exile in Babylon, longing to return to Judah, their homeland. And they were wondering, there in exile, where is God? Has God abandoned us to stay in Babylon? Was He unaware of our circumstances? If not, why wasn't He doing something about it?
And what happened, you see, is they began to think their thoughts about God instead of thinking God's thoughts about Himself. And what were they doing? They were doubting. They were questioning. They were very despondent in their outlook on life. I've had some experiences in my life, and I hope you've had some similar experiences where when something happens, we immediately begin to try to figure it out. Come to some solution or some answer. But I need to be reminded that I was starting with my thoughts about God rather than listening to what God said to us about Himself. And what a refreshing thing it was, had been for me in some of those instances, to be able to stop and back it up and say, let's get this on the right track. That God is who He says He is, and the circumstances in my life and the world do not change God in the least. When you have some experience like that, you begin to experience a peace, realizing that you can't figure it out, but God is in control. He tells us of His power. He tells us of His might. He tells us of His kingly rule. But He also reminds us of His tender care and concern. As a shepherd cares for his sheep, so does the Lord care for His people. And I realize that includes me. And that's the message of this passage of Isaiah. I tell you, my friends, if you read Isaiah 40, and I've read it over and over and over, there are rivers of deep and unfathomable truths in Isaiah 40. So much so that I think we would need a super submarine or the latest spacecraft to discover the depths and the heights that Isaiah 40 speaks to. In this chapter, it deals with compassion because it reveals to us a God who desires to comfort his people. But he knows he has to do that because some of his people are so fragile they can't handle the full truth. Or they are so weak that others of his flock may actually be in denial. But God speaks to his people and he says, listen, though you are in exile in Babylon, I'm going to show you some things that will encourage you, that will strengthen you, that will give you hope. If you listen to what I say, and you see, I prepare a highway upon which you can return to your homeland. It's not an easy road, but it's a road that will take you safely to where you belong. I want you to believe that, he said. I say emphatically that though the grass withers and the flower fades, the word of the Lord will stand forever. And you can trust my word. I do not lie. I do not deceive. I do not attempt to deceive. Now you can believe what I'm saying. So why won't you listen to me? And why won't you believe and have hope? Think about it. Behold your God. He said, when you see me as I want you to see me, one of the first things you'll see about me is I am the Almighty God who rules over all things. And I know that's hard for some of you to believe, he said, because you're saying, well, if that's true, why are we in this predicament? Why are we in exile? Why are we not back in our homeland? Others may find it hard to accept my sovereign rule, God says. They'd rather have I can figure it out and I can work it out myself kind of attitude. But he said, I want you to see me and I want you to know me as I reveal myself to you. Yes, I am all powerful. Yes, I am sovereign over all. And I want you to see me just like that. I'm not some false God that man has crafted. I'm the King. And I want you to see me not only as the Sovereign and the Almighty, but I want you to see me as a God who speaks tenderly and carries me to my flock that I shepherd. And I want you to see me carrying my little sheep in my arms and giving particular care to those who are with young. You see, what's happening is Isaiah 40. In one sense, God is giving us a panoramic snapshot of who he is. But then he's going to allow us to see some of the details in that picture. He said, I want you to see me as the Almighty God who rules over my creation. But I also want you to see me as the tender, loving, caring God who ministers to my people. And the reason I want you to see me that way, he says, is so that you will know that I care for you. And I'm able to do something about the needs in your life that only God can do. Yes, he said, Jesus said in the Gospel of John, he knows his sheep by name. He leads them. He carries them in his arms. He even lays down his life for the sheep on the cross. So yes, God is a mystical God. We can't know everything about God. But we remember that God came in the second person of the Trinity, the God-man, to dwell among us. The Word become flesh. He came to live and to die for us on the cross. That He is both God and man. And Isaiah doesn't hesitate to speak about God anthropomorphically here. That is, using terminology that man can understand and grasp. But let's zoom in on one of the details of this panoramic picture. Look at verse 10. In verse 10 he says, "See, I'm the Lord God who comes with might and rule. I want you to see my creative power," he said. "I created the waters. I created the expanse of the heavens, the dust of the earth, the mountains and the hills. I measured them. I marked them off. I enclosed the earth. I weighed the mountains and the hills." Yes, I even know how much Stone Mountain weighs. I even know how deep the Gulf of Mexico is. I know exactly because I'm the architect. I'm the creator. I'm the builder. I made all things. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And as the creator God, he said, "You can't compare me with any other. Though men may use the highest technology to try to craft idols," he says, "out of the finest metals, and those who can't afford the metals try to do so with the best wood that will not rot," he says, "those things are nothing. They set them up so they will not fall, but they do fall." So the question is, why does man try to do what he really can't do? Idols are nothing. They do topple. They don't stand under pressure. Remember the story of the prophets of Baal and Elijah on Mount Carmel. Idols are nothing but man's feeble efforts to keep him from seeing God as to who he really is, the Almighty, Sovereign, Creator, and Ruler of creation. And again, when I think about those prophets of Baal that day on Mount Carmel, crying out to their gods who were no gods, and there was silence and humiliation and so on, my heart hurts a little bit for them. They had to be embarrassed. But to believe that we can define God on our own, that we can construct our own ideas of God, is utter nonsense. And so Isaiah wants us to resolve to focus on thinking about God as God wants us to think about Him and enables us to do that in the Scriptures and with the Holy Spirit. If we don't do that, our thoughts about God will be there, even in idolatry, but they may lead us to the wrong conclusion. And I remind you that if our thoughts about God contradict what the Bible says about God, guess whose thoughts are wrong? The Bible is our authority. So, he said, "Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from before the foundations of the world that I told you the truth from the very start? And I've told you the truth ever since. So why won't you listen to me? Why won't you believe me? I'm not only the God of truth, but I'm completely trustworthy. Look around you and then look into the Bible. You will see me," God said, "in everything. In the natural world, you see my handiwork. The balance and the order of creation are the results of my working. I sit above the circle of the earth. I create and I sustain my creation by my power. Before me," he said, "the kings and the princes and all the mighty men are nothing." Now what God is doing in verses 21 through 24 is actually chiding his people for not believing what he has said and done. You see, we can't ignore what God says to us about himself without paying a price. Look around at the price people are paying today for not believing God and not trusting God as he reveals himself. The late T.S. Eliot, the literary figure, wrote a poem about the empty, hollow men. And he was right on target with Isaiah's words that God makes completely empty those who deny him and refuse to believe what he says. He said, I am the sovereign God. I never grow weary. I never go to sleep. I never slumber. I'm always watching over my creation. Not one hair falls to the ground without my knowing it. Not one idle or meaningless word is spoken without my hearing it. You can say, my way is hidden from the Lord. He doesn't know what I say and what I do, so I'm free to say what I want to and do what I want to. But that's not the way we learn who God is. God is omniscient. He knows all things. He knows what we're doing, he knows what we're thinking, and he knows the words in our mouths even before we speak them. So can we really say whatever we want to say and do whatever we want to do and think whatever we want to think? Can we really say so what to all of that? God knows it and God sees it. I think Isaiah 40 is a great passage to read over and over to be reminded of God's sovereignty and God's fullness. To remind us as Christians, particularly as Presbyterian and Reformed Christians, why we believe what we believe about God. He's shown it to us. Our faith and our knowledge is built on what he has shown us and told us. But to see only this part of the picture is to miss another part of the snapshot, and that is that God, who is like no other, and to whom no other can be compared, a God who can do all his holy will, also reveals himself to us in a very personal way. Our God is a personal God. Now that doesn't eliminate all the mysteries, I said, surrounding him, but it tells us that the God who made us in his likeness, in his image, he did so that we might know him and serve him with our lives. This great God that Isaiah writes about is also the personal God who desires to have both a personal relationship with us and a corporate relationship with his body. Now, why would he allow that? Why would he allow us to have a relationship with him? After all, if he's the all-sufficient God, he doesn't need us. He didn't need to create this world and universe in order to be God. Why would he let us know him and come into his presence and then by his Spirit? Why would he live within us? Well, Isaiah tells us in verse 9. In verse 9, God desires to be a part of his creation. He wants to be a part of our lives. He invites us to come into the Holy of Holies. And then he invites us to come meet with him at his table. As I read this passage this past week a number of times, it was as though God was saying to his people, why won't you listen to me? Why won't you believe what I'm telling you? I'm your shepherd. I care for you. I love you. I don't want you to be reduced to nothing and to emptiness. I don't want you to be lost and dried up like the grasshoppers. I don't want you to be reduced to oblivion. I want you to love me. I want you to focus your life on me. I want you to trust me. I want to be your friend, and I want you to be my friend, and I'll be a friend who sticks closer than a brother. And that's where this mystery makes another appearance in the story, I think. God, the Almighty Creator of the universe, wants a relationship with His people. He wants to be with us. God wants to protect us. God wants to provide for us. God wants to love us. And what does He want from us in return? Sacrifices? No. The Lord Jesus Christ was that sacrifice that satisfied God's wrath. What He wants from us is to love Him, to believe in Him, and to obey His word. That's what He wants from us. And you know what? He said, I don't want you to make of me some kind of dumb idol, because I know you by name. Dave, Dan, Jacob, Jay. I know you by name. The shepherd knows his sheep by name. He doesn't invite strangers to this table. There are no strangers in God's family. And what He says to us is, come to me. Worship me. Love me. Obey me. Think about me the way I want you to think about me. Please don't try to fashion me into a man-made idol that's nothing. When you're weary, God says, I want you to come to me and find strength. Whether you understand what's happening in your life or the world around you, I want to give you strength to hope and to go on. Remember, I'm the Almighty God. I give power to the faint. I increase your strength. Even those who are near the point of exhaustion, though we've been completely wiped out almost by our situation, I want you to remember that I will renew your strength. I will enable you to run and not be weary, to walk and to not faint. And all you have to do is do what I say. And think like I want you to think. You know, my friends, when I think about all of this, I don't want to think my thoughts about God. I don't really want to try to make a craft some kind of idol, false image about God who is nothing and not responsive to me. I want a God who is strong and mighty and able to deliver when I need Him. When I need strength, I want my God to be there for me. When I tend to be weary and stumble, I want a God who can pick me up and put my feet back on the highway. So I don't have to understand why the towers were attack. I don't have to understand beltway snipers. I don't have to understand devastating hurricanes. I don't have to understand tragedy after tragedy to know God. But I can know Him in the midst of those kind of situations. And I hope you can too. But you know, sometimes I get so frustrated with myself and trying to know God, I feel like at times I may be going backwards faster than I'm going forwards in my faith and my knowledge. And I know I need to press on. I want to believe that God is sovereign. I need to believe that. Primarily because that's how He reveals Himself. And that's what He wants me to believe. I need that in order to have meaning and hope and purpose in my life. I want to know that my God can really do what He says He will do. He can work all things together for those who love Him. And I'm so grateful this morning that God spoke these words to us in His Word, that we might know Him, and that we might love Him, and that we might follow Him. The question is, will we listen? I don't know what's going to happen in our world this year. There are a lot of things going on that trouble me. There's some things in my own life I don't know how it's going to play out. And I can play around with different scenarios, but then I have to come back to square root one and believe that God knows. And His grace is enough for our every need. And I'm going to say, Lord, I want to know You like Isaiah writes about You. You want to know God that way? Do you? I really do. Isaiah tells us how this can be a reality by loving Him, by repenting of our sins, and believing that He is our God. Please believe that, brothers and sisters. Let's pray. Father, thank You this morning for being the sovereign God who meets every need of our lives. Thank You for revealing Yourself to us in this way and showing us that You are the one and the only true God, and may we have no other gods before You. And Father, if there's someone here this morning that has not trusted his or her life to You, I pray that Your Holy Spirit will work in a way to bring that person or those persons to salvation, to know You like we're talking about You this morning, as the sovereign, personal God who loves us and cares for us. Father, I can't imagine how it would be to live one day without the knowledge that You love me and You care for me. Thank You for doing that, oh Lord. Unworthy as we are. In Jesus' name, amen.